Amongst the millions of stories in this world, this one began as a story too, but seeped into our souls and became a part of our culture. A timeless tale that still breathes in India's temples and shrines, bylanes and highways, ballads and songs too. It has romance and action, suspense and drama too. And this is a story that is an inseparable part of my childhood. On the face of it, it exemplifies the victory of good over evil. But in reality, it's a symbol of the battle of the soul that takes place within, as much as it does on the battleground. My name is Amish, and I am an author. You must have figured out that this story is that of the Ramayana. But this is not a story. It's a philosophy. A philosophy that has inspired an entire nation, indeed many nations, to walk the path of Dharma for millennia. But I'm not here to tell you this story, and neither will I explain the philosophy behind it. I'm going to take you on a journey with me. One that a crown prince of the solar dynasty undertook during his 14-year-long exile. We are setting out on a 5,000-kilometer epic adventure to discover how the Ramayana still binds the soul of our nation.
Ayodhya wouldn't be Ayodhya if it hadn't been the birthplace of Ram.
Chitrakoot is immersed in the spirit of Ram.
Yes.
It's a very holy place.
Is this story just the universe of a great writer's imagination?
This is the beauty of selecting this cave. It took care of all their needs during the 11 years they spent here.
My personal belief is that Hanuman was born here.
Ravana used this cave to hide Princess Sita here.
So Sita was actually kept here?
Yeah.
We will unravel the hidden layers behind the characters of this epic.
Shubhnakha was sexually bold and confident. She was a princess.
And we'll discover the life force that is Ram.
The name Ram contains the whole universe within it. Everything works out if you chant Ram Ram.
We'll bridge mythology with geology.
This is the most favorable place on Earth to build the connection between India and Sri Lanka.
And also cross over to Sri Lanka to uncover who was Ravan, a 10-headed demon or a genius ahead of his time.
Ravana is a hero. There is no two words about it.
The most fascinating thing what we found in there was a sign which resembles the most modern spacecraft.
We are on a quest to reveal some exciting secrets as we set out in the footsteps of Ram. The story of Ramayana begins with the great Narad, who was a god sage. He once visited the great sage Valmiki at his ashram that was located at the banks of the Tamasa river. Now, Narad was considered to be the one who knew anything and everything about the cosmos. So Valmiki took the opportunity to ask Narad if there existed an ideal man. A man in the entire universe who's blessed with every virtue known to mankind. One who all of humanity can look up to as a role model of dharma and virtues. To this, Narad smiled and said, "Yes, there is someone."
From the great Ikshvaku's line he came, steeped in virtues, paths they say, in scriptures brilliant, in glory bright. Gifted, accomplished, a legendary famed. He was known to all, by Ram's name.
Today I've come to the place where the greatest scion of Ikshvaku dynasty, Ram, was born. Ayodhya, Uttar Pradesh. The Ikshvakus were the descendants of the sun, the solar dynasty or Surya Vansha. The founder of the dynasty was called Ikshvaku. He's also known as Rishabdev, the first spiritual teacher and creator of the Jain faith. Ram was born in the 81st generation of the Ikshvaku bloodline. But there's one other distinguished descendant of the same lineage you would certainly know of, Gautam Buddha. That's right. Experts say that according to some Buddhist texts, Gautam Buddha was also born in the Ikshvaku dynasty in the 139th generation. Think about it. Rishabdev, Ram and Gautam Buddha, all from the house of Ikshvakus. It is said that if there was a city that personified faith, spirituality, valor and justice, it was this. It was considered the seat of Dharma. Ayodhya was the capital of the Kosala kingdom and Dashrath was its emperor. His three queens were Kaushalya, Sumitra and Kaikeyi. But they had no male successor to the throne. King Dashrath performed a special sacrifice and they were blessed with four sons, Ram, Bharat, Lakshman and Shatrughna. Not many people know, but according to some versions of the Ramayana, the four Ikshvaku brothers had a sister who was named Shanta. That is King Dashrath and Queen Kaushalya's firstborn child. The eldest sibling in the family was a daughter. Shanta not only was beautiful, she was accomplished, well-versed with the scriptures and knew combat too. But where did she go? As per a belief, Shanta was adopted by Kaushalya's childless sister who was married to King Rompad of Andhra Pradesh. Interestingly, it was Shanta's husband Rishi Rishishringa who performed a special yagya for King Dashrath, after which he was blessed with four sons. But it was Kaushalya's second born, Ram, who took the center stage in the story that we know as the Ramayana, that is Ram's Ayan, or the journey of Ram. It is said that this story of Ramayana was written by Maharshi Valmiki in the form of 24,000 verses some 3,000 to 4,000 years ago. This is also known as Adikavya or the first poem on the planet. Some believe that Maharshi Valmiki could not read or write. That means he was not literate and he gained enlightenment by performing penance. But the fact is that Maharshi Valmiki was India's first known poet. Today we are on our way to meet someone who's a poet and a scholar. He has authored many books and is a national awardee too. The Prince of Ayodhya, Yatindra Mishra. Yatindra bhai.
Hello Amish.
How are you?
I'm good.
Seeing you after a long time.
So good
time.
To see you. Yeah, it's been a long
yes.
time.
Please come.
Yes, sure.
Ayodhya and Ram have always been at the epicenter of Indian culture.
In India, our biggest superhero is Shri Ram. In all his various manifestations, his deeds, big and small, his character, his personality is so multi-layered, like a superstar that a scriptwriter imagines, who has the best possible morals and values, he should have this, he should have that. And as a writer, I would say the credit for this goes to definitely Valmiki, and then go to Goswami Tulsidas for conceiving this character. If you are looking for the compassionate Ram, one who's a kind-hearted emperor, then I would suggest you can study the Ramcharitam.
Yes.
If you want to recite the Ram's story collectively, then I would suggest you should go to Ramcharitmanas and you will get to know everything about it.
Yes. We Indians never seem to tire of this story. Why is it that a common person connects with it so much? What makes it so relevant even today and timeless too?
Because it's the story of the struggles of an ordinary being. You will find the answers of all your hardships, all your problems through Ram's conduct. I personally feel that Even after thousands of years, millions of centuries, or the passing of an era, you know, values don't change, truth doesn't change. If there's a story that breaks the barrier of language, that breaks away from caste or creed or faith or religion, I think it has to be the Legend of Ram.
While in conversation, Yatindra told us about a place in Ayodhya that left us simply astounded. As per the Ramayana, Sita's father invited many a suitors to a special wedding ceremony. It was here that Ram won Sita's heart and hand in marriage. But contrary to perceptions, they spent 12 years in Ayodhya before they were exiled. We are entering the Kanak Bhavan, which they say was a wedding gift from none other than Ram's stepmother, Kekai. Was this the magnificent place where they spent the first 12 years of their married life?
Kanak Bhavan has an ancient legend associated with it. There's a story, a brief, that Queen Mother Kaikeyi gifted this to the royal couple when they arrived in Ayodhya after their wedding. You know, there's a famous song that says, Siya ji ki mu dikhai gajab guiya, Kanak Bhavan ke ahate mein bheed bhari hai, aa rahi hazaro raniyon ki sawari hai, sab gaave sahana gajab guiya. So, you know, when these songs pass down in colloquial and oral tradition, then no historian can record them. So there is no way to check their veracity. Yeah. It's kind of belief. And belief says that it's been given by Kaikeyi and she loved them dearly.
One can still feel the love and devotion at Kanak Bhavan. It also holds whispers of a secret society that worships Ram as the supreme manifestation of passion and desire. They look up to him as the avatar of romance. Tell us something interesting about the Ram Rasiks.
If you ask me, I would say it's a very beautiful and a very unique society. According to their traditions, they, I mean the menfolk, worship in feminine expression.
Right.
They associate themselves as sisters of Sita and consider Ram their brother-in-law. So it's a very extraordinary relationship.
Okay.
And one more interesting thing is that even when they perform all these ceremonies in the temple, they cover their heads and faces with veil, the way women do. To me, this is the ultimate form of devotedness, the epitome of devotion. And this practice of the men using veils is found nowhere but here.
Amazing, amazing.
Very few people outside of Ayodhya would know about this extraordinary tradition. And also that Ram and Sita spent the first 12 years of their marital life in Ayodhya. And that too in a palace gifted by Kaikeyi. Wow. We're going to find out more about this most intriguing and layered character in Ramayana, Kaikeyi. With me is the best-selling author Kavita Kane. Kavita's books explore the lesser-known female characters in Indian mythology.
I think Kaikeyi, she brings drama to the narrative. She truly personifies the drama. Kaikeyi herself is a very layered character. I mean, if you see, she's the perfect mother. She loves Ram. She loves him. Then why did she suddenly change her color? It starts from an episode of what they call the Kanya Shulk. When Dashrath wanted to marry Kaikeyi, he goes to her father. And the father actually doesn't want her to marry Dashrath because he's old. He's relatively old. His daughter is beautiful, young and bold. She was one of the few princesses who knew warfare.
Correct.
And importantly, after 7 sons, he had a daughter. So she was literally like a darling daughter. So to preserve his daughter's right, he extracts a promise from Dashrath.
Before their wedding, King Dashrath made a commitment to Kaikeyi's father that if she bore him a son, he will be the successor to the throne. So Kaikeyi was only invoking this promise. Was it wrong?
According to her, she is doing the right thing. She was asking for her right, her son's right, and she's not asking for anything unreasonable. She's asking for the promise that Dashrath made to her father. Here, I think Valmiki is asking the audience to think about why Kaikeyi, who was a loving mother, suddenly turns into a wicked stepmother. This entire moral dilemma, as you say, I think it is personified completely by Kaikeyi, and her entire progression of character is based on this particular incident. And that is the wonder of Valmiki, and he does it with every character.
So does this mean that Kaikeyi was only playing a role on a larger cosmic stage? Think about it. Had Kaikeyi not asked King Dashrath to send Ram on exile, then how would he have set out on his journey? And had Ram not gone for his exile, then how would we have gotten Ramayana? I had a question that was bothering me. Kaikeyi wanted her son Bharat to be the king. But why was Ram sent exactly on an exile of 14 years? I mean, why not 5 years or 10 years or maybe even 15 years or 20 years? There could be one plausible reason. Some experts say that, as per the legal system during that period, if a landowner did not assert his rights on, say, his property or a piece of land for 14 years, then it was understood that he lost control over that property. So it's possibly one of the reasons for sending Ram on a 14-year exile. Ram set out on his journey with Sita and Lakshman. A 14-year odyssey lay ahead of them. But it was this very journey that would leave a trail for mankind to follow. Today, we are heading towards the first stop in their epic journey. That is the Prayagraj confluence. Out there is where the two holy rivers, Ganga and Yamuna, converge. But according to our sacred texts, it is the Triveni confluence. The Ganga, Yamuna and Saraswati meet here. While the Ganga and Yamuna are visible, the river Saraswati is unseen. But the real identity of this third river lies in the stream of faith held on to by millions and millions of Indians who come here to take the holy dip. It was at this holy place that Maharshi Bhardwaj had a hermitage. One of the greatest legends in our ancient scriptures, Maharshi Bhardwaj was a disciple of Valmiki. He is believed to be the Manas Putra or mind-born son of Brahma himself. Ram, Lakshman and Sita reached the hermitage of Rishi Bhardwaj in Prayagraj and asked him for an advice on where to spend their 14-year exile. The Maharshi not only blessed them, but also asked them to follow the Yamuna southwards till they reached a mountain, and that place would be perfect for them to settle down in. So onwards we move to a landmark destination in the journey of Ram. Chitrakoot. Even today, Chitrakoot is considered holy because of the penance of the great sages. When the trio got here, a strange twist of fate played out. They met a great sage, in a way, their own creator, Maharshi Valmiki. We authors usually have a technique that's called author surrogate, where the writers actually come face to face with their characters, they talk to them, they get to know them, and that too in their own story. It is proved time and again, historians have acknowledged, that the very first person to apply the author surrogate technique was our very own Valmiki. Chitrakoot was considered a very spiritual place,
Sages meditated here to attain deliverance. Right now, we are heading towards the holy Kamadgiri mountain, where Ram, Lakshman and Sita chose to settle down. We are on the Lakshman hill and there behind me is Kamadgiri. It is believed that for 11 years, 11 months and 11 days, Ram and Sita stayed on that mountain there. And this is where Lakshman stayed. And as you can see, a large number of devotees are here to offer prayers to them. And it's really heartwarming to see this devotion. Centuries have passed and the world has changed. But the spiritual energy of this place still endures. Pilgrims do a 5-kilometer long circumambulation to ask for the fulfillment of their wishes. But there's a secret that lies buried within this mountain. To help me unravel the mystery, I have with me a hydrogeologist who's found a place in the Guinness Book of World Records for finding groundwater at the highest altitude in the world, in Ladakh, Dr. Ritesh Arya. So, Dr. Arya,
yes.
We've heard that there's a local belief that the Kamadgiri mountain is hollow from within.
Mm-hmm. Come, I'll show you. The hollowness you're referring to, I'll explain you what geological hollowness is about and how it comes about.
Right.
Can you just see this?
Oh, wow.
Just see this.
Yeah.
You can see that the area is hollow and has formed a whole cave within the mountain.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Wow. So are there many such caves in this mountain?
Yes, the mountain is made of limestone.
Right.
And one of the key characteristics of limestone is that it doesn't break easily.
Oh.
Basically, what happens is that when some amount of water seeps into it, it starts to dissolve and gradually forms a cave. So what you're referring to as hollowness is actually the progressive dissolution of the limestone. These limestone deposits happen only in a marine environment. That too in the deepest part of
under the
ocean.
Sea?
Not under the sea. It was under the ocean.
Wow.
I'm not talking about the sea. I'm talking about an ocean. This is about 1.6 billion years this has been dated to be.
Wow.
And the crucial factor is that we are talking about the origin of the earth. Just look at these rocks. These are the oldest remains of fossils on this earth.
I get that. Correct.
So just imagine when the earth was being formed.
Yeah.
What was happening? The gases were cooling down and rocks were being formed. There was one gigantic rock formation. The way we see the separate continents now, it wasn't like that. There was a single landmass and it was called Pangaea.
Oh.
So one landmass, one sea, and today the position that we are seeing in Chitrakoot, this is the result of continental drift.
Yeah.
I strongly believe that our sages recognized this oneness.
Yeah.
And because they acknowledged this harmony, they gave a lot of importance to Chitrakoot because it was centered here. So maybe over the years, this scientific reason of oneness has been forgotten.
Right.
But the original oneness, the birth of the universe that's in our sacred texts, that original wholeness is what we are looking at.
I like the way you correlated continental drift with our spirituality. The mysteries of Chitrakoot do not end here. We're off to a place whose name itself holds a secret. They say that Ram held his court here during his exile. But this place is very special and has even confounded scientists. Dr. Arya, please tell me,
yes?
Why is this place called Gupt or Secret Godavari?
This stream of water that you can see here, it appears here in a mysterious way. Because if we go further, it's very difficult to trace out the source of water.
As to where is it coming from?
Or where it's coming from, right. When we investigated this, we were amazed with the findings. Because without a water source, you cannot get limestone caves. So, in case there isn't a perennial source of water, you will not get a cave like this.
Oh. There are some intriguing legends associated with the secret Godavari. They say when Ram held court here, gods and goddesses came from afar to seek his blessings. Located in Nasik, Godavari Devi also wished to visit him. But her parents didn't grant her permission to do so. So she came secretly to meet her Ram. Even today, 1,000 kilometers away from Nasik, below the ground inside a cave, a stream flows. Could this be the same Godavari river that came to Chitrakoot surreptitiously?
All the answers can be found in these rocks.
Ah, okay.
Can you see that these rocks here are made of limestone? But if you look at this one or this one here, look at this.
Yeah.
And even this one. There is no homogeneity in these. So these were deposited here in a flood deposit.
Ah.
See, if you look closely, there must have been a flood in the olden times.
Right, and a lot of stones.
And where does the flood occur? In a river. So this was a river channel.
Yeah.
And if we track back,
yeah,
we can easily trace out till here. We can probably trace out many, many kilometers to figure out the source of this river.
Oh, this is a very unusual natural phenomenon. For one, the river source is uncharted. Then it emerges from the cave and disappears into the ground again. Geologically, this unique feature is known as a blind river. But why did Ram, Sita and Lakshman come to stay here from time to time?
So the sages of our past were knowledgeable scientists. They wouldn't just tell anyone to come and live here.
Yeah.
So there were three reasons that was observed. First being a perennial source of water.
Yeah.
Second, adequate space. When we measured the cave's dimensions, we found it could accommodate a sitting arrangement of about 150 to 200 people.
Wow. So the court could have been held here.
Yes, court could have been held comfortably. And it had a capacity of 300 to 350 people where they could stand. They had all their arrangements here.
Correct.
Third, see how small the entrance is.
Quite small.
It gave protection from all kinds of animals and even enemies.
Correct.
And look at this. We have reached the end. But if they had to live here in this cave, they required 24/7 fresh
water.
They
needed water.
And if you look at the quality of water, it's very good for drinking. If the water quality is pure, there will be fishes. Even today, if you can see, there are fish in the water. So this is good enough to drink. So this is the beauty of selecting this cave. It took care of all their needs during the 11 years they spent here.
Wow. Whether this is geology or mythology, it's up to you what you'd like to believe. But what I find most mystifying is that a whole river can just disappear. We are here in Chitrakoot. My map tells me that we are approximately 300 kilometers away from Ayodhya. Legend says that Ram spent 11 years, 11 months and 11 days of his exile here, along with his wife Sita and Lakshman. But then why did they move elsewhere? They could have spent the next 2 years here and gone back to Ayodhya. But why did they leave this beautiful, pious, holy place? We need to find out. With us is Dr. Ram Avatar, who's been doing his research on Ram's forest journey for almost 5 decades. Will he be able to provide an answer to my question? What compelled Ram, Lakshman and Sita to leave Chitrakoot?
Just a little ahead from here, beyond the Atrimuni Ashram, the Dandak forest begins. Dandak forest was controlled by demons. They had created an oppressive environment in the whole region. The sages couldn't do penance, the women. When Ram arrived at Sage Sabhang's hermitage, all the hermits shared their plight, how the demons threatened and victimized them, tormented them and even killed their brethren. Ram set out into the forest, reassuring them along the way. But when they reached Siddha Hill, he inquired about the mountain of bones.
Come, Ram, come. See this bizarre sight. The holy saints and their plight. Where many a twisted pathways goes, there live a cruel foes. These wicked demons the hermits kill. Those who live on Chitrakoot Hill.
So Ram was overwhelmed with the atrocities. It is believed that his eyes welled up with emotions.
Right.
And he resolved, Nischarheen karu mahi bhuj uthai pankheen sakal muni ke ashramai jai jai sukhdeen. Ram made a grim resolution that while this was just one center of the demons, their stronghold was in the Dandak forest, that he would go into this citadel, into their bastion and destroy them once and for all.
While the sages were quite capable of defending themselves, but it is believed that if they took somebody's life, their spiritual energies would diminish and fade away. That is why Ram, Lakshman and Sita had to leave Chitrakoot. Because they had to destroy the demons at their garrison itself, at their root. Because the demons were not only oppressing the sages, but they were also harassing the common folk. and it was said to be Ram's duty as a warrior prince to protect the feeble. Paripalaye Durbalam. Dandakaranya. The name is enough to send shivers down your spine. Spread over 92,000 square kilometers. Even today, this forest is as formidable as it was described in Valmiki's Ramayana. It stretched from the Vindhya mountain range in central India to the Tungabhadra river in the south. This dense forest has been the backdrop for many a myths and legends. The root of the name is Dandak Aranya, meaning the forest of punishment. And surviving here was not at all easy. If we go by legends, the ruler of this kingdom was a king called Dand. They say that one day, the arrogant king violated the chastity of his guru's daughter. Infuriated, the guru cursed the king and his kingdom and laid it to sheer waste. But when Ram, Lakshman and Sita set foot in this fearsome forest, something instantly changed. The trees turned green and the fruits on the branches turned sweet. As per local myths, this region was the mighty Ravan's domain. Ravan's stepbrothers Kar and Dushan were the chieftains of the area and commanded an army of 14,000 demons. The demons wreaked havoc in the villages and mercilessly killed the hermits. The sages and common people were vexed and helpless. Ram and Lakshman killed the demons one by one. Peace and harmony gradually returned. The sages, the hermits, and the local villagers heaved a sigh of relief. Right now, we are also entering the region of the legendary Dandak Forest, in the footsteps of Ram. With time, the expanse of the forest has shrunk. But a large part of it still exists in the Bastar district that is in the state of Chhattisgarh. Vishakha Khetrapal is going to be with us for this leg of our journey. She's a sociologist and has been a UNESCO research fellow. Exploring unusual cultures and traditions is her passion. Today, we are visiting a tiny village where for the locals, Ram is their life force. There, very being. In the Chandli village of Chhattisgarh, there's a very unique tradition that exists. Around the year 1890, a man named Parshuram was banned from entering the Ram temple, as he belonged to a lower caste. To protest, he adopted a unique practice. He tattooed Ram on every inch of his body. And this became a tradition. Gularam Ramnami is a leading member of this community.
Even if you chanted Ram Ram, you were put through severe torture. The sovereigns had declared that people from lower caste could not chant the name of Ram. Going into a temple was completely forbidden. We could not even take the name of Ram. So the community decided to make their heart into a temple. So the tattooing of Ram Ram is beyond the chanting of the sacred scriptures. By reading or writing them, interpreting them, singing them, you reach a level where you feel compelled to write Ram Ram everywhere on your body. That's when your heart transcends all and your soul becomes virtuous and pure.
The Ramnamis live a very simple life and have relinquished many customs and practices. All rituals are fulfilled with the chanting of Ram Ram. Most people of the Ramnami community live along the banks of the Mahanadi. The full-body tattooed people are called Purnanakshik, which means from head to toe. But there are barely 5 to 6 people like this left in the entire world. These people are of the belief that the tattoos remain with them
even in their next life.
Whoever comes into this world must go one day. He or she has to die. But we Ramnamis bury our dead in the soil.
You bury them?
Yes. We don't burn our dead as per our usual custom. Not because we are associated with a particular faith, but the Ram Ram that is tattooed on the body.
Right.
So that is the reason we don't want to burn the body. And hence, we merge it with the five elements. We are neither Hindu nor Muslim, nor do we follow the Sikh or Christian faith. So where were we when we were not born? But as soon as a child takes birth in a Hindu home, he becomes a Hindu. It's only after he or she is born that they are ascribed a faith. If he takes birth in a Muslim home, he becomes a Muslim. That's why in our Ram Navami community, there is no importance given to faith, nor do we give it any consideration. Whatever faith you may belong to, whatever religion, as long as you are pure at heart and will not harm a living being, you are a Ram Navami. You have been derived from the name of Ram and are immortal. You don't die, you don't burn or perish. You aren't visible, nothing. Ram Ram Naam ke bhitar Brahm jeevite lok. Jivichiti bij nachatra nagra migratho. So the meaning of what I've said right now is that within the name of Ram, this whole world, the complete universe exists. So see, like when you say the word city, it's only two syllables, but so many people and inhabitants exist within that. So similarly, in the name of Ram, the whole universe is packed. By chanting Ram Ram, everything falls in place.
With respect and devotion for Ram in their hearts and their body immersed in his name, this is possibly the last generation of these Ram Namis who we've had the privilege to meet. But their connection to Ram is as strong as the connection that we share as a nation with the Ramayana. So Ram, Sita and Lakshman had covered roughly 1500 kilometers on foot through forests, mountains and rivers. When they entered the Vidarbha region of Maharashtra, they were confronted with a strange sight. Even today, the sight is amazing and could very well be the location for a sci-fi film. According to the scientists from NASA, about 50,000 years ago, a meteorite struck our Earth with such great intensity that it formed a huge crater. This lunar lake is the result of that cosmic impact. In 2019, an IIT Mumbai study revealed another astounding detail, that the minerals found in this crater have the same composition as those found in moon rocks. The same moon rocks that the Apollo missions brought back as lunar samples. It is said that when Ram, Lakshman and Sita reached here, after walking many miles, they were drawn by the clear blue water. They hastened their steps towards the lake, but they couldn't drink the water. It was not to be drunk. It was saline. To quench Sita's thirst, Ram lifted his bow and shot off an arrow. Even today, only 100 meters from the saline lake, a sweet water source exists. It's hard to even process what we've just found out. We're saying that roughly 50,000 years ago, a meteor hit our planet and a lake was formed. And in the Ramayana, Maharshi Valmiki has described it extensively. That means astrophysics meets mythology. Just imagine moon rocks in the path of the Ramayana. Was Maharshi Valmiki an author or a scientist or both? We are now heading to our next major destination. One where the story of Ramayana took an unexpected turn. Panchvati, located on the banks of the Godavari in Nasik. It is believed that it is here, under the shelter of five banyan trees, that Ram, Sita and Lakshman settled down with the intention of spending the last year of their exile in peace. But suddenly, a tempest arrived. Meenakshi, one with the beautiful fish eyes. A stunning princess appeared on the scene. She was immediately attracted to the handsome Ram and she proposed to him. Ram tried hard to explain that he was already married
and that he wouldn't even look at another woman. But Meenakshi wouldn't listen to anything. This Meenakshi was none other than Ravan's younger sister, Shurpanakha. Inflamed by the rebuff and in a rage and of course jealousy, Shurpanakha there and then attacked Sita. Lakshman, in order to protect Sita, pulled out his sword and cut off Shurpanakha's nose. It is also said that this was the spot where all of that happened. And that is how Nasik got its name. Nasik, meaning where the Nasika or the nose was cut off. To know more about Shurpanakha, I once again have with me the renowned author, Kavita Kane, who's written a book on Lanka's princess, Shurpanakha. So, tell me one thing. In many of the versions that you've read, there's always this dichotomy about Shurpanakha, about her character, that was she a villain or a vamp? Because as we know, she ambushed Sita, she tried to attack her, or was she a victim?
I think these are two extremes, victim and vamp.
Yeah.
I think where this particular episode is concerned, she was, I think it's a complete misunderstanding. It shows the cultural difference between the two brothers and Shurpanakha, you know. The two brothers are from Ayodhya, slightly conservative, a little traditional.
Okay.
And I think she was a sexually bold, confident woman.
Shurpanakha.
Yes, absolutely. They couldn't handle her. They couldn't handle her overtures. They couldn't handle the situation. And on her part, on Shurpanakha's part, I think she took the rejection very badly.
Yeah.
And she vented it out on Sita instead of, it. So I think things just went terribly wrong for her.
In a way, even if we look at it in today's context, when conservative cultures and very liberal cultures, when they meet, so obviously there are cultural differences, misunderstandings take place.
I think Valmiki actually, through this small episode, it's so dramatic and it has so many consequences. As far as I know, it is one of the most important episodes which actually pushes the Ramayana forward. It progresses. Mm. Because if Shurpanakha had not entered the scene, there would have been no latter part of Ramayana at all.
This was the trigger for the war.
Yes, completely.
This one event would change the course of the Ramayana. This incident that took place in Panchavati was the precursor to a chain of events that not only changed the Ramayana, but it added an interesting and a brand new chapter in our country's glorious history. Meanwhile, somewhere in the southern oceans, a storm was brewing. Shurpanakha was Ravan's sister, who not only was the king of Lanka, he was mighty, formidable, extremely learned, and an authority on the sacred texts. The sun and moon lost their momentum when he was in a rage. The planets changed their orbits, and even the gods shuddered with fear. So if you look deep, Ravan was the one humiliated. Furious at the insults heaped on his sister, he descended upon Panchavati with only one objective, that was revenge on Ram. Ravan shamelessly used deceit and sent the Ikshvaku brothers away from Sita in pursuit of a golden deer. But before he left his sister-in-law, Lakshman drew a line of protection and asked Sita to remain within it. And then he appeared in disguise as a mendicant and lured Sita into crossing the line of protection. Interestingly, this line is not mentioned in the original Valmiki Ramayana. It was shown as a concept in Tulsidas's Ramcharitmanas. And even today, thousands of years later, the line drawn by Lakshman or Lakshman Rekha is still used as a concept. But coming back to the story, the moment Sita crossed the line, Ravan appeared in his actual fearsome form and he kidnapped her.
By force, by power, by sheer deceit, Ravan abducted Sita in conceit. On his Pushpak Viman he bare his captive through the fields of air. When the mighty sun saw him tear her away, even his glorious light began to fade.
But who was the one who took Sita away? And where did they go? The answer is only known to us. But Ram and Lakshman were clueless. They knew nothing. Where would they begin their search? How would they even find some clues? The journey ahead is a long one, and there's a lot more to this story.